All right, well, it's time, and we'll call the International Falls Coochin County Airport Commission meeting to order. And note that Commissioner Brian Briggs is absent for this meeting. Anyone that wants to do public comment for the commission? Hearing none, we will move to the minutes of the February 22nd meeting. Your pleasure with the minutes.
I would move on the minutes of the agenda.
Motion by Commissioner Nevinen to approve the minutes of February 22nd meeting. Second from Ron?
Yeah, second.
Thank you. Commissioner Harvey? Discussion on the motion or the minutes? Hearing none, all those in favor of the motion to approve the minutes signify by saying aye.
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 Those opposed, same sign. Motion is carried. Financial statement. We have terminal project claims of $738,251.93. Minnesota Energy Resources claim $4,682.14 was paid previously. And then under regular claims, we have $26,118.67. And note the big one is Shannon's at $13,000. And as the manager explained before the meeting this morning, that we've had trouble with the furnace and just had to have Shannon's out there to keep it going. So, good time to get a new furnace.
Is that internal or the terminal?
I'm sorry.
The furnace, is that for the terminal?
It's the old.
Yeah,
the old terminal.
The old terminal.
Well, that's nice to put money into, isn't it?
Right. And under the profit and loss, we show a on the terminal project we're down $104,367.51, and on balance sheet we have expended $10,304,113.39. Your pleasure with the claims and the financial statement.
Move to accept.
Motion by Commissioner McBride to approve the claims and accept the financial statement.
I'll second.
Second by Commissioner Nevinen. Discussion on the motion or the finances.
Mr. Chair, and maybe Kyra will report on this in terms of getting that paperwork in, so that I know we've got a lot of bills here that we'll get reimbursed. Okay.
Further discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor of the motion to approve the financial statement and the claims signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
Those opposed, same sign. Motion is carried. Financial statements are approved. Thank you. Rick, you want to give us an update on the project?
They are making roof panels today, or this week, and they'll start installing them next week. And then on the inside, they're framing walls and soffits. Plumbers are roughing in. Electricians are roughing in. HVAC's going in. The floor has been polished in the main area, and the generator showed up since we were here last. That's sitting there. All the mechanical stuff's on site, the water heater, the air handlers, everything's ready to go. So just putting her together now.
And the roof panels that they're putting on, do you have any damage from the wind?
No, they weren't made yet.
They weren't made?
Yeah, just the underlayment kind of got blown off. We had two layers, so the second layer got blown off in spots. The underlayment didn't get wrecked at all, so that was all good.
So no real damage?
Nope.
That's going to cause any problems or delays? Or?
Nope, nothing like that.
Okay.
Mr. Chair?
Please.
Did we make up a little bit of time?
Yes, a little bit of time.
Okay.
The nicer weather helped a lot, so they should have the roof pretty much done maybe by the end of next week, they think, if the weather holds out. Once they're all made, he said it don't take long to put them in. They got all the prep work done and ready to go. They're just making the panels because they're one piece from top to bottom, so.
Excuse me, and when you say the floors are polished, I guess the you give me a little more detail? I'm not
The waiting area and the main lobby.
Yep.
They came in last weekend or 2 weekends ago and ground it, and then they burn it. So it looks like it's got a clear coat on it, but it doesn't.
It just helps for wearing?
I don't know what it helps for.
So the public areas, we have the polished concrete floors. So you do the grind, you kind of take off that top layer of the cream and expose a little bit of the rock and the fines. So it looks kind of almost like a terrazzo kind of finish. And then they put in a densifier so it hardens that top layer for a wear surface. And then they usually put like a penetrating sealer there to prevent any salts or whatever from getting into that or something.
So is that the finished surface
yeah.
then?
Yes.
And they don't wax it, nothing, right? That's
correct. Yeah, you don't want to wax it because you don't want it to get slippery. So you just use that penetrating sealer that soaks in and protects it. But, yeah. So that'll be the kind of the ticketing areas and the main hall when you enter, and then the spaces beyond will have carpeting and other finishes.
Is there a fair amount of drywall going on? I see Davis drywall.
They got the walls up. The drywall itself hasn't really started. A little bit here and there, but
the walls
are framed and they're doing soffits and stuff.
And yep. They dropped that ceiling down in that one area that was gonna.
Some of them they have the ceilings down, but not all of them. Yep.
One of the questions I have, and I know you said electrical work is being put in. Are we going to be able to take if we? And I know that I don't believe we've purchased any security cameras as part of the project. I don't remember that we did.
And I think they're on that camera.
Yeah, I would have to double check the package, but I think we have some covered down.
Yeah.
And so is the conduit and that available to put in additional security
cameras? Equipment is typically a low voltage, so you don't need to have that in the conduits. Run it through your concealed spaces.
If you do want to add some in the ceiling, though, we'd have to do it before the tugging crew goes on.
And what time is that?
He thinks he'll be done roughing in by the end of this week, and then they're still waiting. Did you ever get the sample?
No.
Did you get it?
For
the tugging crew? He said he was being next.
I believe it arrived yesterday in our office.
Okay. So it'll be a few weeks still. Before, because they'll have to get it ordered.
And so what would we need to put in some type of a...
You'd have to get the wire there, because you won't be able to fish the wire through after the ceiling's in.
So it sounds like maybe the best thing is for us to review what the current work scope is, and then get back with you and show you the plan of what we have currently included, and if there's something additional you might want. Determine what it is that we have to
rough
in additional at that point.
I just think that the security cameras are proving to be so helpful today in so many areas, and just want to be sure that we've got them where they can help us maybe at least have the wire there.
Sure.
Whether we decide to purchase the cameras and
okay.
Secondary. I think you're right, Steve. If we could there's a schematic that shows where we're going to have cameras. I just didn't remember that I thought we had not put any of the that kind of technology in. I know we didn't buy any televisions to put up on the walls. I know that was trimmed out. So yeah, we could take and review that, just feel better about making sure that we're ready for the future with the security cameras.
We will research it and send a quick snapshot of what we have currently.
Okay, very good.
So, Mr. Chair.
Please.
So you need cameras and some kind of recording system. I mean, there's more than just cameras.
Yes, yeah, there'll be some type of recording system, but I don't know how many units that we would have in all of that. I thought we had eliminated it, so I was thinking about it here in the past couple of weeks. It would be helpful to have, and some, you know, outside for folks around the parking lot too, because that building is left open for hours on end. Further questions for Rick on the project? So panels continue on as the weather holds, and the roof will get sealed up then?
Yep, we're gonna make them all this week and start installing them next week.
Other questions? Covered it all. Thank you.
All right.
Keep us going out there.
Thanks.
Thanks, Rick.
We move to the engineer's report.
And
who's leading off today? Bob?
Sure.
Have you got any bonding money with you yet?
You got some money, Bob?
No.
No?
Okay. No bonding money. I really don't have. It's just a phase one bonding and phase two bonding, I guess, to talk about. So just was emailing with Don this morning, Don Berry at MnDOT. We still don't have the bond funds.
Released,
exactly.
There's 2.2 that's out there, but we haven't been able to put our hands on it.
Right. So it's been released by MMB, Minnesota Management Budget. It's been in MnDOT's hands now since January. So it's been circulating around MnDOT for signature and gone, as you guys know, back and forth many times just for new signatures because they made mistakes on their end. So latest is that Kyra got everything back, all the signatures back to MnDOT yesterday. It's in MnDOT's hands. Circulating more signatures. Payments can be made once they have the bond funds between the 1st and the 15th only. So we're hoping that they get everything prepared on their end so that you guys can get a payment here right at the beginning of April. So right now the local funds have been used to supplement the lack of bond funds. Kyra's been telling me we're down to about $10,000 in local funds remaining. But I don't know if that's enough to make this month's payment. It's not enough to make this month's payment. So, you know, we either need to get the bond funds or some funding needs to come from another spot.
To continue the contractors being paid.
Right.
Yeah.
Or, you know, the other thing would be, yeah. The other thing would be is to, you know, to start making calls to MnDOT. I don't know if, you know, calling Cassandra is probably enough. I don't know what to do anymore.
If I may, what's interesting to segue on that, do respect the whole organization. I hope they improve it. It's not, but I'm returning a lot of my calls and safety issues.
And that's our MnDOT Aeronautics.
Yeah, truthfully. I don't know what
they've been most responsive over the years, but
they're
well. And this one is with the bond. It's above Aeronautics, and that's why I don't think they have the influence to get the signatures done. They can only do what they.
So
can
it's in within MnDOT.
Within greater
it's not,
MnDOT.
Yeah, yeah. It's not within the Aeronautics division.
Right. But that doesn't address your concern.
Oh, no, and I'm just saying that I think, but I...
To be clear, though, we did everything on our side.
Several times.
Several times.
We signed, I don't know how many different bond agreements with the state.
So these are the state bonding funds?
Yeah, 2.2.
Not any money that's been done.
This is the 2.2 from
2014.
From the legislature, from the bond.
Yeah.
Bonding bill.
They passed in January.
And one reason it was sent back the first go around was because the language that described the building of the project was taken right from the bill, right from law. We inserted it in, but it had strike throughs in it because the first time through it had some language, we had to change it. And they wrote it in with strike throughs, we included it with the strike throughs, and MnDOT Contracting said, can't do that. Needs to be cleaned up. So we kept it just the way they wrote it.
Yeah, just what the bill had.
Just what the bill had in it. Which I figured was the way you needed to do it. But that's just one example. There's been lots of other. I don't know, Cairo may have some other examples of things we've had to
change. To clarify what Bob's clarifying with me, I don't get a sense that they're really that motivated to go after the money.
That makes sense. I've been intimately involved in this process, and I don't understand what they're doing. I don't know who all needs to sign it or what the process is, and I don't think internally they know what the process is. They have assigned a new attorney to develop a new process around this.
I think that's
to try and figure it
very
out.
True.
So I they recognize that there's not a process. But it doesn't help our cash flow.
And I don't know that it's going to, it may help to call Cassandra, but I mean, she'd have to, may need to call the commissioner and ask him what's happening.
Yeah.
But basically though, I mean, we've got a week and a half. Well, at first you said we can issue checks after the first through the 15th.
The bond funds would be, Don Barry would release bond funds back to the commission.
Not until after the first.
Not until after the first.
Only a portion, not the full amount that we of the bond funds that we've used to supplement. It would only be a portion.
Oh, it would only be a portion of it? Why wouldn't you release the whole amount?
I'm not sure. But I know the amount that he was going to release before we had the issues with the agreement was only roughly $250,000 we've spent. Our bond funds have been way more than that. Unless it's because of that first package where they can't use the bond funds for. I know he did reference that for the projects that had already started.
So you think we ought to make some calls to MnDOT?
I think so.
Okay.
I think you guys have been more than patient.
I get the sense Don is kind of frustrated with the whole process.
Don is frustrated too. Like I said, they're doing everything they can within aeronautics. As of this morning, it's going to be signed by Cassandra, but then it goes out of aeronautics. And once it's out of aeronautics, Cassandra doesn't have any more control.
Sequentially, do you get Bach involved?
If we needed to, I mean, I think I'll call MnDOT and see what they can tell us and tell them what our situation is here. And we've upfronted the money for the project and we're looking for reimbursement. And we've hopefully met all of the criteria that they have in releasing those funds to us.
Call to even the commissioner of MnDOT?
Yeah. Charlie Zelli, yeah.
Charlie Zelli. Maybe have to even go to the governor.
You can do that.
I'm not saying
I mean, I feel like we're almost there, but I've been saying that for how many months?
That's right.
Right? We can't go on another month.
All right.
The question is, is it just the MnDOT issue, or are other projects having the same trouble getting their bonding money released? Have you heard anything?
I haven't heard anything. And I know that when the bond funds are allocated for a project, they are administered by different departments, different agencies. And this one is through MnDOT, and it's through Aeronautics. And Aeronautics, this is the second one they've done, second or third. And they, the rules change each time. So Donberry has done Hibbing and International Falls. I don't think he did Duluth. But each time the process is different.
Yeah, MMB took care of their process in January, and money was turned over to MnDOT, and it's been going around at MnDOT.
And there were a lot of delays on the MMB side as well.
It was
leading
for a while,
up to that point, but. But I haven't heard, to answer your question, I haven't heard if others would have. You would think that by this time, anyway, bond funds are issued all the time, that the process would be nailed down.
Yeah, it's not their first rodeo. I mean, it's
and the state's got a good bond rating, so it shouldn't be any problem selling the bonds, and so the money must be there if MMB has released it.
Yeah.
So, all right, we will follow up with MnDOT and see where
okay.
we have to go.
That's phase one. Phase two, I haven't heard anything where that's at. Everything is still the same. $3 million is still requested. We're still waiting for.
It's in the governor's bill. It's in the Senate bill. I still have not seen the House bill. I don't know that the House has a bill yet on bonding. I think they're still holding. I was listening to public radio this morning, and it sounds like the Southwest Rail is still it's clouding up some of the issues.
So,
again, and so. I don't know if you saw the Duluth paper on Sunday, but Commissioner Myron Franz had an editorial in there. He was kind of poking the legislature to do something on bonding, and it was a good editorial. I clipped it out and sent it to him and thanked him for the good work. And I had been at a dinner with him a couple months back, and he told me that the governor was very definite, wanted the Falls Airport project to get finished. So, if you got the commissioner, you got the governor. I don't know who else you can get. So we'll just have to wait and see if the House comes to an agreement on having a bonding bill for phase two. Further, Bob.
That's it. We're getting together on Friday as a design team to begin to finalize the plans for phase two.
So we'll be ready to bid.
You're
given
ready
a
to
bonding
bid
bill, but if we don't have a bonding bill, we hold off on bidding.
Right.
Okay. So I'm backing up to phase one briefly.
Sure.
Do we need to ask the uncomfortable question of we've got February billings that you just approved, but we've got March coming quickly.
And how do we pay for this?
How do we pay for this? And if that bonding money is not transferred, I'd like to think we don't need to stop the project, but work continues.
That just
so
costs so much money to do that.
Right.
Does that make sense? I don't know. Mayor and the city and the county may have to sit down and have that discussion.
Yeah, I think that I'll certainly talk with the city administrator and see where we're at, but I'm sure we're probably already cash flowing some of this.
Not yet?
Okay, but the February.
We have funds in our general account we might be able to. I can talk to Betty to see. Take it out of that and get back once we get our reimbursement.
Okay, so take a look at
the
funding in our general fund and see if we can use those. All right. So that might help us to get through February, but it won't get through March. I don't think there'd be that much there.
I mean, we guarantee the funds are there. It's
well,
just a question when they're going to get.
And maybe,
get.
Maybe I got to ask right. MnDOT if they can. They confront some money here to.
I think it's a valid question.
Yeah.
Okay, I will be making some calls with regard to that. Further, Steve or Bob or?
Nothing further from my end.
Destin?
That's it.
Okay. Please.
Just want to thank the follow-up effort for getting some of those folks paid from one contractor.
Yes. Yes.
Appreciate it.
Very important.
Yeah, getting some of those subs paid very, very helpful. I just gave you another one this morning. Hopefully we can get them taken off the list. We've paid Hammerland. Are we still holding on Hammerland at this time?
We are. Hammerland's February application was pulled from the package you just approved, so until they provide us documentation that everybody's clear, and I think they have now, I got a lien waiver from them just this morning. But I did send them your note on the other local business that needs to be paid.
Very good. Okay.
So I assume they will bill for both February and March in this upcoming March pack, provided everybody has made whole.
Great.
Credit to both Steve and Bob.
Yeah, there was a lot of effort. Need to take care of the local subs.
Absolutely.
Thank you. Okay, further?
The only other one was we did have a meeting with Avis. Avis had called.
Yes.
It's later down under new business, but they had called with some questions about the new terminal. We've been dealing with the local folks here, but this was somebody more at the corporate level. So we did have a meeting with him earlier this week. And we're going to be inviting him as well as the other car rental agencies and SkyWest probably one of the next upcoming meetings on the 5th to do a walkthrough of the building and just answer any other questions that they may have. So just to let you know that's being done.
And their concern is from...
They were just having questions about their inserts into their counter. Sometimes we provide the shell and they provide an insert, similar to SkyWest. And another concern was around signage and how many data drops they would have and so on. Some of the things you see here are, I believe, from the Duluth terminal. And they were wondering about what is their sign going to look like behind their counter? Is their electricity going to be there? How many data drops do you have at the counter? How many data drops in the office and so on? So we answered all those questions for him, but he did want to make an on-site visit to see the actual space. And the other question that came up is which space are we going to get?
Is there four? Three
there
or four?
There are three.
Three?
Yeah.
Well, there's four desk locations, but only three of them have an office associated with it. So.
And Destin was astute to say, well, the one who pays the most gets first choice. So,
that's fair.
Money talks.
So that may be a question for you guys to assign spaces.
Draw the names out of a hat or something, I don't know.
Alphabetic.
Okay. So you've had the discussions with Avis and you're going to have them up to visit? The site. Do you have some additional information from Avis?
Yeah, well, he had just, some of these pictures of his, wanting to make sure he would prefer a lighted backboard versus the electronic and some different things like that, as well as the counters. And then they wanted some additional set signage in the parking lot so that it was clear of where Avis's cars are. Kind of had a request of which space to have, but that no one he sees the area and things like that. But them being an out-of-town based company, it might be more suitable for them to have an office space there. But he also had a couple of questions in regards to if the commission was going to start charging a concession fee. He said it's fairly standard in all other airports, and INL is the only airport that he knows of that does not charge a concession fee. That is basically where they charge their customers 11.11% and then 10% of that comes back to the commission. So he said it's an easy way for the airport to get revenue off of them. And he also said there is a facility fee that most airports will charge, which is a certain dollar amount per day per rental agreement up to 4 days, 4 to 5 days. He said Duluth is currently charging $4 a day for a 4 day maximum. And that addition, that money would be on top of that 10%. He was just giving some ideas on that, but he didn't know if the airport was going to stay the same, because right now we're not charging any concession fees or anything. The only revenue we get from them is their lease payment. So, and after doing this ACDBE report,
sorry, Karen.
It's very eye-opening, the amount of revenue that these rental car companies bring in through our airport. So if 10% of that revenue was to come to the airport, it would be a fairly significant amount.
Do you know who administers that then? Do they, or how other airports handle the administration of those funds?
I would have to find out more detail on how all that works. I did reach out to Sean and Hibby, to see, you know, how they do it, or you know what they charge for fees and things like that, and I haven't heard back from them, so it was just late yesterday when I reached out to them.
I guess to start, so do we have power on the back wall so that they can have a lighted sign?
Yep, we do provide power. I think it's a little bit of discussion between all of them, because I think whichever direction we go, we just want them to be all consistent. So I know sometimes, you know, you'll have just a lighted sign, but in other locations that go to actually a TV monitor that gets mounted there, so then you can have changing information. So I think whichever way we go, we just want them to all be consistent. They've expressed a preference to have just an illuminated sign, but I think we'll want to sit down with the other vendors or potential vendors to fill those spots, and so see if we can get everybody on the same page.
All right. Yeah, concession fees, new to me. I guess I had never heard of the small airports collecting a concession fee, but maybe it's a revenue source that we can certainly look at. We need to have the car rental companies here, and I want to make sure that that's going to happen first. At the same time, if they're open to helping to collect some money, why work with them? Other questions or thoughts on the part of the commission? Or anything else, Kyra, that you need to share there? Okay. So we'll need to put that, get some more information and follow up on that piece.
It seems like all of their concerns with the signs and everything is not unreasonable. I mean,
no.
It's a reasonable request on their part. So.
And Thor will decide where they're going to have their cars.
Who's
going
to give which office?
Oh, yes, I can. I know. I can smell what's coming.
How many parking spaces each one gets out there? And, we'll work with you, Thor.
I cannot respond at this time.
All right, further questions on the terminal project or operations there? And so now we have the pavement rehab. Has Sean got that?
Yeah, Sean's got that.
Wonderful.
Got.
All right. Thank you, Bob.
Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you. Welcome.
Destin, thank you all for your good work there.
I'll take the hot seat here.
All right. You can lead us on the pavement rehabilitation project for this summer.
Sure. It's a project that was identified on the CIP for this upcoming summer. It's our continuing pavement rehabilitation that we do, that has been done every year for the last couple of years, keeping the pavement operational out there. Last year we did it was almost a crack seal type project. They used a mastic product that filled up the cracks, some of the wider joints. And it, from my perspective, seemed really successful.
Absolutely.
We had a good contractor. We were able to minimize closure on the runway, and it seemed to be the best value of getting the crack sealed and improving rideability, and just kind of getting the work done.
Absolutely.
It survived the winter really well. So I think what we're proposing is to do something very similar this year, be a crack sealing project that would just continue the work that we did last year. There's more need than money, so we're just going to keep working away at it and doing what we have. So the project would be approximately $150,000 to $200,000. I think last year's was, $160,000, if I remember right. So we'll continue the work basically in the same dynamic as that. I gave Kyra a design proposal right before the meeting to proceed with the design effort for that $9,300. And that would be for basically some of the work that we've already done with the FAA, the pre-application environmental review, and what they call the engineer's design report, which is presenting the means and methods so the FAA kind of knows what we're up to, what we're doing. And then that will also allow us to proceed with creating the bidding package. It'd be a fully bid project that we'd probably bid, I'm guessing, early May. So we would bring it to your May meeting for approval or consideration, depending on how the bids turn out.
Well, our May meeting is generally the last Wednesday of the month, and so I don't know if you want to wait that late or do you want to do it the, would you have it ready for the last week of April?
We probably could. We'd like to advertise for 3 weeks so we can get that on the street right away. We would just need, in addition to the design proposal, just permission to advertise. So if you're willing to do both of those, we can definitely proceed with that. We could project bid opening prior to the April meeting on our calendar.
And the April meeting is the 26th.
Okay.
So it's just about a month from now.
So what we would probably do is do it the Tuesday prior. That way we can save.
Unless you want to just set a date in May and be sure that you're going to have, we can certainly adopt that date, and then you can open the bids and bring them to the May meeting for award. So if you want to have an additional week, I mean, it doesn't have to be done at we can approve that date in April for letting the bids or for calling for bids.
Okay. Let's plan for the Tuesday before the April meeting. I think that would
the 25th.
The 25th.
Okay.
And we'll have a bid opening at 2 p.m. And we'll plan for that.
For the May meeting or the April meeting?
The April meeting. So April 25th, we'll open the bids and then present them to the April meeting. Is that?
Because we're already in March now. We haven't advertised yet.
Yeah. So we would have to coordinate. We'd have the 3 weeks if it was April 25th. Although there's no harm in waiting because we're going to be waiting. It's going to be packaged with the terminal meeting or the terminal portion of the project. So to one grant application, so we need to verify what's going to happen with the bonding before we can actually submit the grant application. So maybe it's best just to wait until May.
Okay.
So. I think after all that, maybe I'll bring an advertisement for bid request in April.
All right.
Prior to, we'll do that prior to the May meeting. So for your consideration today, I think would just be the design proposal to proceed with that effort. And that would bring you all the way through the bidding process for that.
All right. And then approving the contract for $9,300?
Correct.
Okay. All right, so we have a request on the part of Short Elliott and Hendrickson to approve the design proposal for the pavement rehabilitation project and approval of their contract of $9,300 for that project.
Motion.
Second.
Motion by Commissioner Nevinen, second by Commissioner Bride. Discussion on the motion or the design proposal for the engineering contract.
Mr. Chair.
Please.
Sean, you said something kind of struck me. For a smaller rehab, but we're going to do, you said something like environmental review.
That's correct. For every project done on an airport with, even if you use federal funds or not, it's a very simple review.
So it's not a big drawn out?
No, it's what they call a categorical exclusion. So for every project, you need to go through the paperwork Basically, it's just highlighting the project limits, and then you answer the questions.
Grind out a crack and refill, and you need to do.
Yep, they just need to verify that they've, you know, looked at it.
Disturb any widgets or pigeons or mice or.
Sparrows.
Sparrows.
Yeah, 200-page document, yes.
Yeah, it is, it's more of a paper chase than anything, but they need to have something on file. It's the, it's all part of the NEPA Act, to, in order to say that the FAS complied with that, so.
Why do you need to justify, justify their existence?
Yes.
All right, further questions or discussion with regard to the motion then to approve the design proposal and the SEH contract for the pavement rehab project?
This is one easy question, because I don't know any better. Is this an annual maintenance thing? All right.
Yeah, keeping the runway in good shape, not letting the moisture get down into it and cause.
Freeze and break.
Freezing and heaving and so forth, and I don't know if we'll do one in 20, probably do one in 2018, but then we'll start rebuilding the full runway in 2019, I think would be the plan.
And even as part of this project, we're going to be starting to be strategic on where we're doing that work. As we phase the runway, obviously, we want to do the parts that are done last, so that we can get the most value out of what we're, the work we're doing. The stuff that's going to be replaced first, we probably won't treat it all.
And how about the taxiway? Does this include some taxiway work?
Absolutely, yep. That's, I think, where most of the ridability issues are, as the joints are over, that the airplanes are feeling right now. So that MASTIC really helps out with that.
Good question.
And maybe one more thing to add to made me think of that. This is a project that's funded by the FAA at 95%.
Yes.
2.5% by the state. So the local share is actually only 2.5% of that projected $200,000. So a very good value for the effort.
Okay, a couple thousand dollars.
Well spent.
Yes. Local money, so very reasonable. All right, no further discussion. And chair to call the question. All those in favor of the motion to approve the design proposal and the SEH contract, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Those opposed, motion is carried, and the design proposal and contract are approved. Thank you.
We'll get to work.
All right.
Thank you for going.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Sean.
Further under engineering, have nothing under old business. We'll move to new business. We've already, I think, is there anything further on the Avis that we need to do? Okay. The Minnesota Airports Conference, the MACOA Conference, is April 12th through the 14th at Mankato, and approval for members of the commission to attend would be in order.
I'll move.
Motion by Commissioner Nevinen to approve travel expenses for the members of the Airport Commission to attend the MACOA Conference.
Second.
Second by Mr. McBride, please.
Do you typically attend?
Yes.
Okay.
And I'm planning to go down. I want to just, I guess, keep our face in front of the folks at FAA in case we have discretionary. I assume some of you folks will be stopping there at the MACOA conference.
Yep,
I think last year we ended up having a meeting with Cassandra, the MnDOT folks. I think it was very helpful at Brainerd to do that, so plan to go down there again this year. So. Discussion on the motion then to approve the expenses for travel to the MACOA conference in Mankato. Hearing none, I'll call the question. All those in favor of the motion signify by saying aye.
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 Those opposed, same sign. Motion is carried. Thank you. Go to anything else under new business? Please.
Mr. Chair, I sent forward that email with the President Trump's preliminary budget with
the essential air service.
EAS and the concern around the state. We received emails from AMC. They're urging all airports to start getting their hands around this and
excuse me.
Maybe get your legislators to express our concern as to what it would do to our communities if we lost EAS, and it's just not international fault, it's 150 some communities.
You
And you had also the people, regional and rural communities that elected President Trump, so he needs to be well aware of that.
The Local Airline Service Action Committee has put together a letter that we're sending to the Minnesota Congressional Delegation. Individual airports are also sending one. Here's a copy of the Chisholm Hibbing letter that's gone out. I think we should send a letter, a similar letter, on behalf of the Falls International.
I think that one email, if you do get with John Ungaro.
Yes.
And I think John had asked Indian all airports to write something up and send it in. I think we need to do that. If we need to do it by motion, I'd be willing to have that motion.
Yep. Okay, motion by Commissioner McBride to send a letter to the Minnesota Congressional Delegation with regard to Essential Air Service Program. Yep. Continuing.
Support.
Support by Commissioner Nevinen. Discussion on the motion of the letter. Glad you brought that up, Commissioner McBride. We just in last month got approval from the FAA that here's the award here, $2 million for this airport to have SkyWest fly in here 12 times a week. So that's certainly right now very key, and I don't know how many saw the article in the food paper on Sunday, but that article was also picked up by some national groups and they're passing it around. And as Commissioner McBride pointed out, the Association of Minnesota Counties is also pushing on this, and the League of Minnesota Cities, I believe, has also picked that up. I was told this morning that they have started to push on that. So it's a key piece. I will also contact the Minnesota Chamber of Commerce. They have in the past supported this effort. So we'll reach out to all of them. Yeah. And send them copies of the letter.
And I know AMC is, as the lobbyists, they use McGran, Dennis McGran, I think is Andy Burmeister group in Washington, D.C., and it may get to the point where we may have to talk with AMC or talk with those people, but I mean, this is, I think, a proposed budget for 2018. We have some time, but we need to stay ahead of this.
And just want to, I don't want to get the alarm too high, but at the same time, I think you're absolutely right. We need to be on top of it. Every administration since the Carter administration back in 1980 has taken a shot at the Essential Air Service Program. It doesn't do anything for the general fund budget. There's no income tax money that's going to come out of there to support this program. But for some reason, it's
the alarm went higher this time.
Yes. Yeah.
Mr. Chairman, John Ungaro is a really good voice for us. He'll get out in front of him. He's a good guy.
Certainly got some great folks there, and we'll make sure that the governor's office gets a copy of it, because the state has a office in Washington doing lobbying too, and so they can call on. I would certainly believe that the Minnesota delegation will all be there in support of that issue.
Well, how many regional airports
in Minnesota?
Five received
essential air service.
Bemidji, yeah. Rochester.
No, not Rochester.
Brainerd.
Yeah, Brainerd, Thief River.
Thief River.
Hibbing, Falls, and Bemidji.
So Rochester's not on.
Further discussion. All right, all those in favor of the motion to send a letter to the Minnesota Congressional Delegation signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Those opposed? Motion is carried. That will be done. Thank you. Further under new business. Move to the manager's report.
Yes.
How's the snow and ice?
Yeah, it's been interesting. Let's discuss, starting off with the wildlife plan. The wildlife plan was actually completed back in November of 2016. There was a issue with the FAA, combination of things. FAA will not release the funds for a project unless the wildlife plan is complete, along with now, sequentially, late fall, we had a visit by one of the safety folks from Inland Aeronautics. I think I shared this information before. She pointed out some clearing and engraving requirements on the aircraft, which we've completed as of last week. In fact, we were burning late in the evening last night some trees that we've removed, what have you. We'll continue with that project. We should be done by the end of the week, I'm assuming. With that, the miscommunication was as follows. When I sent the wildlife plan to all the players in the mix, what I learned, interestingly enough, is the FAA, the ultimate bureaucracy, does not have enough data per user, per se. They can't take that large of a file. But they did not tell me they couldn't take the file. So whenever it was last week, Sean, they had sent out some emails stating that they had not received. We responded quickly. Tremendous amount of credit goes to Sean because he put it in a form for me and sent copies electronically. And I believe hard copy too, Sean, is that correct?
Correct, yeah.
Yeah, to all the players. The one very good thing about the 200-page-plus wildlife plan is it generates the need to make paper. So I would say that's probably, choosing my words, to probably one of the good things in the wildlife plan. So Sean has copies, I believe, or a copy, correct?
Yes, one at the airport, and then left over there.
Right.
And, mailed one both to Tracy Schmidt and then the wildlife.
Is that interesting reading?
Uh-huh. Yeah.
If you want to have her read my paper.
Oh, good Lord. I better stop now. It's unbelievable. It really is.
So hopefully we got our base covered
for
2 years.
We have that covered, so we'll see where that goes.
FAA could not receive a PDF file with 200 pages in.
That's what absolutely is the truth, which is totally crazy but true. Like a stick. I mean, nothing. Really quite amazing. And what I really enjoy is they always do the accusational tone first before they ask. You know, and it's irrelevant that you send them an email and you show the attack and you sent them back specifically December 2nd. Oh, yeah, we can't take that much data. Thank you for telling us now.
We're good.
Anyways, it's the detail. And it's the way it is. Collaborating with craziness.
So, for the clearing project, do you have to send aerial pictures?
It has to be approved. The Sean and team have to sign off
on the clearing.
It's unbelievable. They have to sign off. That has to be a certified injury report that's been basically the information. So,
pretty pictures in there?
Yeah, they're very good at that. In the CH, they have color photography. So it's really.
And it's all required to get the next year's grant, so the 2017 grant, you have to show your number of just.
Yeah, right. So we got, I shared with Bob a few days ago that we just got aggressive and just got proactive with it because it wasn't going to do us any good by waiting for to see up to the last minute, so we just.
Is it under 13 or?
Combination of all of us actually approach end of 2, 2, 4, 3, 1 end of exactly all of them. Yeah. In fact, the largest trees we removed, Feller Buncher and the Skidder, we moved on the approach to probably 2-2, just inside the fence. If you try to see it, so that project for the first time.
The ground is still frozen, so it's good time to get in.
Late
there.
At night, early in the morning, you can run the equipment. Fascinating. Yesterday, as an example, with the temperatures in the low 20s. And very cold human skin, relatively high wind chill values. You still soft on top, though. It's unbelievable. The power of the sun this time of year, angles changing. So, yeah, but we'll work on that. Continuing, planning on going to the Mankato conference. I'm going via Granite Falls. I'm going to go visit Ron, so then I'll come back to from that, Kato's gonna work fine. Snow blower issue. Our newest snow blower, which is now 5 or 6 years old, the Oshkosh, this winter has proved to be just a Leviathan, just a maintenance nightmare for us. We have repaired it and fixed it and fixed it. And the last snow event, which was rather significant, frankly, it ran for exactly 4 minutes. So shut it down. Thankfully, we kept our older, our 96 model single engine, which on pound for pound, tonnage for tonnage, it has done a lot more than the very expensive,
So high tech. What is Oshkosh saying about?
Great question. I've taken it up the flagpole as high as I can go with Oshkosh and with McQueen, and they said, yeah, you know, you have to make a choice. You come get it and fix it, you don't charge us, you send us a team of mechanics and some electrical engineer types, because literally there's ghosts in the system. It literally is the modern equipment with all the sensors and all the computers and what have you. We have literally changed 80% of the sensors in the internet. I mean, it's unbelievable. I mean, you know, there's a sensor for absolutely everything, limitless. We've changed sensors, computers, coaxial lines, wiring harnesses, and they're scratching their head. And I told them, well, that's not our issue. It's yours. You have to get this thing fixed. So we're going to definitely hold our feet to the fire hard. So
the plan is to not to replace it at this time. Hope to get it.
Yeah, it's not
four or 5 years out of that.
I would think an easy 15. Yeah, which should go really easy. It absolutely should. It's just whether parts need or built on a Thursday afternoon or a Friday, I have no idea. But by their own admission, and they sent us, in my opinion, some talented technicians, and they thought they quote unquote had it last time, and we didn't use it for about a week and a half, and then the latest snow event happened, and it quit. Literally. So we'll keep charging and hitting them hard. Wind, very interesting. As we know, we've had a couple of significant wind events. Historically, the data from National Falls, that's a record for 2 days. We had on the desk, we had 46 knots of wind gusts for over 2 days. Just a tremendous amount of energy to get that done for two straight days. Regarding the reports about the damage to the new terminal and the roof, we were watching it, and my wife called that one morning. I was at work, and she said, "Honey, did you know that part of the roof is in our yard?" And I knew it was just the plastic. We talked about it, so I called Rick Oster. I said, "Hey, Rick," I said, "I realize you know." I said, "But my wife called. She's really concerned that part of your roof's is in our yard." I said, "Thor, we're aware of that." Thank you. So anyway, it was very good. But yeah, they had their hands full.
We lost a couple flights.
We did
because of that wind.
Very interesting. The airline attempted to, both flights, two approaches. Severe wind shear, severe turbulence, and they made the right decision. The second approach, particularly in the afternoon, they were in a good visual range for us, and just even being on the ground watching, and the ride had to be atrocious. So they went back to Minneapolis. So what
happened to the passengers here or Minneapolis? Did they get bussed?
They got bussed.
They got bussed.
Yeah, correct. Okay. Yeah. They changed the plan up a bit. It was 250 degrees and 46 knots. So that's basically, in essence, a dry cross.
Was that a couple weeks ago?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And then Monday night we got some awful wind for.
Which was not forecast.
Exactly.
Yeah.
I mean, there had to be some gusts well over 40.
Yeah, those were 40 knots there, and snow, which none of it was forecast, which was kind of interesting.
It was a smaller cell, though.
Much smaller cell, very intense.
But certainly heavier-looking clouds that came with it.
Mm-hmm. Very, very intense. We had some damage fascia on our hangar door. In fact, we're replacing some of it today. Came off. Now, what's interesting on the snowmobile equipment main door, the 60-foot door, 16 feet tall, unique thing happened. When we were cycling a door, we would normally never open a door past about 35 knots, 30 knots. But we need to get the snow blowers out, or we're not going to be in business. We need to get the snow blower out, so we're not going to. So we were monitoring it. We were taking out equipment as fast as we could, closed doors as fast as we could, also possible. Through the last event, thankfully, that we got the equipment out, a unique thing happened. As the door was closing, a peak gust struck the door across the face of the door, therefore causing a low pressure that actually tried sucking the door away from the building. At the exact same moment in time that there's automatic binders on the door, so the door goes through a sequence, the door closes, it's a bifold door, it has straps that lift the door, and when it goes to the bottom of the stop, then there's literally two cable/arm closures on the ends that put tremendous amount of pressure on the door and close the door tight. When the wind gust came through, it pulled hard enough on that it broke that whole mechanism, which is fascinating. It was literally unbelievable. We were standing there taking cover. Parts and pieces and springs and cable were flying everywhere, and it literally did an incredible amount of force. And thankfully, that the gust landed just long enough so the mechanical portion of the door didn't yield until maximum gust. So after it broke, the door popped out about, for the sake of the conversation, 3 feet, and didn't continue. And literally, I was standing there, and the gust subsided, and the door went like this. And that wouldn't have been good. That would have been major, major damage to the door. So we got it fixed. We got the parts immediately from Swice Door, a Minnesota door company. And we were running 2 days. You could use the door after that. After the wind went down, you could carefully use the door. But I'm just thankful that it wasn't a worse situation. On a political level, you were talking, discussing the governor. I see Tina Smith has announced she will definitively not be running, which in political circles, that's kind of surprising. The information that I had that was relatively close to the sources, she was definitely wanting to run. And I don't know how that'll affect the future. I don't know what's going to happen.
Can we open up wide open?
Yes. And in fact, a gentleman I know who has been considering it, he felt strongly he couldn't beat her. I don't think he probably could have, but we'll see what happens. I think that may be beneficial to him, so we'll see what happens.
And Republican side is what Coleman has declared?
I don't know
there's
if
a Coleman.
Who has declared, actually.
I think it's Norm Coleman's son.
It would be the
St. Paul.
St. Paul Mayor.
St. Paul Mayor?
Yeah. Not Norm, not related to Norm.
No. Not okay. I see that he's got some emails from people fundraising for him already. But then Kurt Dowdett also expressed some interest. Whether he is declared, I don't know.
But other than that, no, not relatively uneventful. Just from an interesting standpoint, been some very unique weather. Very interesting.
Sort of, I understand it. They tried landing and, just discovered that the wind was so bad that they went back to Hibbing and refueled and came back to try it again.
They did. That's exactly what happened. And then they made the right decision. They went all the way back to Minneapolis to get to a good runway. It's not a good correction, a good wind direction for the conditions, yeah. That's about as severe as I've seen. In the middle of that, interestingly enough, we had a Gulfstream 450 that was coming from London to International Falls, and they elected to land. And it's got to be rated max wind for Gulfstream 450. And as we say in flying, he planted it on there. Just two pilots, no passengers, but it must have been a ride. But that's it. Thank you.
Thank you. Any further questions for Thor? No. Manager's report. Thank you, Thor.
Thank you.
Secretary's report.
Complainants are in the packet. We had a Sun Country flight go out last month, so that one is also included. For SkyWest, complainants were up again last month. And I received the signed hangar lease agreement for the KEDA on Lot G. It was approved by the KEDA and Airport Commission back in May in April of 2015, and so we finally got that lease agreement, and KEDA has signed off on it, and now the commission will just need approval and final signature.
And planes are up for a second month in a row. Very good. Actually, third, because I think they're up in December also. All right. Further, Kyra?
Just that hangar lease. I don't know if you want to do a motion for approval or for the chairman to sign.
Okay, we have, and that's with?
KEDA.
With KEDA?
Mm-hmm.
So the Coochie Economic Development Authority lease agreement for hangar site. Pleasure with that.
I suppose I better make the motion.
Yes, yep. That would be helpful.
And just
right,
to be clear,
let me get the motion in a second, then we'll have discussion.
I'm moving.
Second.
Motion by Commissioner McBride, second by Commissioner Norby. All right. Discussion.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. To be clear, it was the last of the new hangar sites, and it's adjacent to the parking lot and the test facility. And we thought it would be helpful to have a buffer there between our activity, and we're using it now. We used it last year for full parking. So it's not a very desirable site from an aircraft perspective.
It is not.
So rather than let it, you know, we're using it, we wanted to formally start paying a lease on that site, and ultimately, that's where we're at.
Okay, so it'll help to support the cold weather testing by having that. As been pointed out, it's not not a great site for a hangar anyway. So. Further questions or discussion with regard to the motion? Hangar site? Chair will then call a question on approval of the lease agreement with KEDA for that hangar site. All those in favor of the motion signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Those opposed, same sign.
I would abstain.
Abstain. So we have 3-4 and one abstention, and motion carries. Thank you. Further, Kyra.
The last thing I have is I spoke with Minnesota Power regarding our budget billing. There's currently a balance due of roughly $6,500 that keeps carrying over each month because our budget billing isn't keeping up with that. After speaking with the representative, her recommendation was one of two things. Either we can up the amount of the budget billing, which would be a roughly an additional $1,500 a month, or we could go off of budget billing and just pay the straight amount that is due each month. So I wasn't sure on how I should like to proceed with that.
Well, and just, I guess I'm not sure why are the costs, is it just because they had some increases? Because I know they did announce an increase there, so that's why we're falling behind.
Do we catch up in the summertime then?
We have before somewhat, but this balance has been running for quite a few months, over 6 months. So
I think we're better off just paying the monthly fee rather than budget it. I mean, we kind of know what it is, right?
For the most part. And then I did explain to her, you know, we have it for the budget this year and everything. It's kind of budgeted out, but
we're about 5,000 back behind.
We have a running balance of about 6,500 after we pay this month's bill.
Oh, we don't want them to shut off the lights.
No. But she said order up our budget by 1,500 a month, and then we would be.
It'd be around 1,500 a month. Yeah, so it'd be closer to around 5,000 per month versus the 30.
For budgeting purposes, it's easier to have a fixed amount.
Well, it is, correct, yes. but we don't want to be carrying this, this negative. What's
I'm not sure which is the best way. Probably just pay the bill each month and authorize prepayment because it's a utility that we've got to have the power. So
we need a motion to pay them the power bill monthly rather than remove from the budget. As a trial, we'll see how that goes.
Okay. Motion by Commissioner McBride to pay the monthly utility bill to Minnesota Power for electricity, and that the payment can be prepaid
right on Miami
because of it's a utility.
Second.
Second by Commissioner Nevin. Discussion on the motion or the electrical bill. And I would include to pay
up or to get caught up. Yeah.
Okay.
They're always on it.
There we go.
No further discussion. Chair, call the question. All those in favor of the motion to pay by the month and prepay the electrical bill. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Those opposed, motion is carried. Taken care of. Thank you. Thank you. Go to reports of members. Commissioner Norby.
I don't have anything extra to offer, I guess. Thank you.
Thank you for being here. Commissioner McBride.
Nothing. No.
Thank you. Commissioner Devlin.
I've not heard a great deal of follow-up on the new schedule. I mean, there was a lot of concern initially, but I'm just going to ask if you're hearing anything or any members are hearing anything as a result of the new schedule?
There was some talk / rumor, conjecture and hearsay about the new schedule. But right now, we're actually, the tone changed. We haven't been hearing much now.
And I think it's still early, but.
Right. And I think with due respect to regarding the schedule, I think that the concern right now, and I'm confident that we'll come out of this EAS issue intact, but maybe that needs to be a reminder that we're very fortunate that we have two jet aircraft per day. That's a pretty sort of small community. That's substantial. One's hard pressed to be concerned about that. I think at this time, not that you are the same, but I think the people are. I think maybe going back over that again, which is a good idea, as we talked about before, definitively SkyWest Delta had looked at the models. They definitively have said this will be better, and we can only put our faith in their decision, and you hope we can pray they're correct.
They study the numbers, and hopefully they're correct. But and so far, we have not seen a drop in enplanements, and so they promised us that they would take and sit down with us again in July.
Absolutely.
And review it, and we'll set that up to happen. So,
question for Thor: where is the regional jets upgrading to the 70 passengers? Is that still in the future?
Still in the hopper. One of the main players in that world is MRJ, Mitsubishi Aircraft.
Mitsubishi, yes.
In Japan, and they've had horrific setbacks.
Oh, really?
Yeah, and the industry was looking forward to that was really going to be the benchmark aircraft for that. And so now that whole thing's been set back, per se. The whole industry's been set back for some reason.
Is that safety issues, performance issues? Or?
I'm assuming certifications, not performance issues, I don't know.
Mitsubishi Heavy Industries, and they make airplanes.
Yeah, it's the whole. They're all under the one umbrella. It's like it's like Bombardier, like Skidoo of Canada, right? Trains and planes, and everything in between.
Yeah.
Snowmobiles, Sea-Doos, right?
I guess before I go, Ken, did you have anything that you wanted to raise with the commission?
Yeah.
Thank you. I would just share with you. Very minor item, but I just wanted to make you aware of it. KIRA
had been told that the Convention and Visitors Bureau here was going to send a letter of support to the Duluth Airport with regard to them wanting to establish direct flights between Duluth and Phoenix. And the Convention and Visitors Bureau is going to send a letter of support for that. And I called Pete Schultz there and said, you know, why would we do that? We're trying to get passengers on the plane here to go to Minneapolis to go to Phoenix. And if we support direct flights and that gets established, then folks have that option of driving to Duluth and getting on a plane rather than getting on here. So I think that they backed off, that they're not going to send that letter of support. And not trying to knock down any other airport, but at the same time, they're not doing anything to support us. And under LASAC and the marketing agreements that we have with MnDOT Aeronautics, no one is to advertise in another's area. So, I mean, I think we keep try to keep the lines pretty clear. So hopefully that will work out. All right, next meeting, that would be in April, and we'd be looking at the 26th. We'll celebrate Administrative Professional Day, so we'll celebrate Tara on that day also. So 8 o'clock on the 26th for the Airport Commission. Work okay for engineering? Very good. All right. Nothing further to come before the commission at this time. We'll stand adjourned. Thank you.